Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Hello, you're watching another episode of Oregon Voters Digest. I have a great show today. I have two guests. I have a local Portland author and performance artist, Jennifer Robin, for the first half of the show. And the second half of the show, I have Christine Van Order. She is a social activist and an aspiring politician. But for the first half, we have Jennifer Robin. Hello, Jennifer.
Hello,
welcome to the
Teresa.
Show.
Thank you for having me on.
I'm so glad that this worked out. I was thinking about interviewing you like over a month ago. I really love your book. I have a signed copy of Jennifer's book. And I read it and I loved it. It's very unique and very courageous. And it reads like poetry, which I really like. When I started reading it, I thought, okay, this is someone who writes poetry. I could tell immediately. What do you think?
Well, it's poetic prose, mm-hmm. and it's nonfiction. And that was one of the things when yeah. I was writing the book and working with the publisher, Farrell House, who mm-hmm. pretty exclusively does nonfiction.
Yeah.
And they approached me because I was writing a number of semi-journalistic profiles and rants, mm-hmm. not just about my personal life, but my observations of the streets of Portland,
sure.
Especially with where my attention was drawn, which is usually to people having nervous breakdowns, people in crises.
Sure.
My attention automatically is pulled by situations where I can tell people are getting dislodged
right.
from
right.
the norms of society, mm-hmm. whether they're physically dislodged or mentally dislodged.
Mm-hmm.
I am drawn to those situations
sure.
and write about them, which this is a collection of short pieces, some
right.
of them as short as one paragraph,
right.
some of them which are more mm-hmm. essay style, but they usually are written with a surreal sensibility
mm-hmm.
because when I see what most people would walk by and go, that's a strange situation, we're not going to pay attention to it, I don't just see the psychology of it, but I get lost in the richness of the other details as
sure,
well.
Sure.
So
yeah.
so there's a lot of poetry that mm-hmm. you can see even from someone eating a scoop of ice cream and it mm-hmm. falling on his foot.
Right,
there's
right.
there are multiple levels of poetry
mm-hmm.
to almost anything that
yeah.
you're walking by.
That's what I really enjoyed about the pieces. They're some are really short, some are much longer. I enjoyed the focus on street people, and I thought, you know, when I was reading this, I thought, wow, this is great, because I don't know of very many writers that focus on that. And I had written an essay a couple years ago, and I called it Street People, something like Street People, People That You Can't Forget, or something like that. And it was an essay about various street people in Portland that I've remembered from the last 20 or 25 years,
mm-hmm.
and seeing them over the years and my interactions with them, and ones that really touched my heart, and ones
yeah.
that I watched self-destruct, and ones that just disappeared, and those people that you can't forget that just stay in your consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So I loved that part of your focus. And of course I love the title, and I'm not going to give away the title, but
Death Confetti.
Yeah.
Do you
yeah.
want me to give it away? Or?
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can, one thing I can say about it is Death Confetti isn't just the title of the book, it's the title of the last piece in the book.
Yeah.
And I won't give away what the last piece is about, but I will say the title describes, the title is works on many metaphorical levels, because it's about
mm-hmm.
us living in cultural debris and being cultural debris.
Right.
We're in a constant state of flux, no matter
yeah.
how much each of us is defining ourselves mm-hmm. as, I know what I am, I know where I'm going.
Right, right.
We are constantly disintegrating,
mm-hmm.
and this book captures that on
yeah.
many levels.
I know you post on Facebook a lot, and I get the feeling that it's part of your process, part of your writing process and your creative process. And you get a lot of great feedback. You know, you have a very large fan base, which I think is great. And you were posting the other day about people growing up and not being taught how to survive
Yes.
Skills. And I'm reading this and I'm like, my God, it's like she's writing about my life. You know, I can relate to that so mm-hmm. well, because that's how I was raised. You know, I was the 7th of 9, Irish Catholic. Neither of my parents really prepared any of us to survive. You were talking yeah. about learning about money and yeah. things like that. I didn't learn how to manage money, you know. I just didn't learn a lot of survival skills. And my husband, Don, is a lot better in certain ways than I am in that regard. But I really enjoyed that post because I could relate to it so much. You know, I could relate to it so much.
Yeah, I find that in our culture, people, it, especially with our current prevailing ideologies in mm-hmm. our monolithic, I would call it a capitalist system, but at this point mm-hmm. it's a plutocracy.
Right.
At this point right. in our scenario, mm-hmm. we have been divided and conquered. And we are told that if we are slipping through the cracks, we haven't worked hard enough.
Right.
And
right.
and the thing is,
yeah,
there are so many unique types of personalities in
exactly.
this world.
Exactly.
And most of us, it's a fiction that we come out of the womb knowing exactly what to do, as if we're born in some perfect laboratory
right.
and our parents are going to love us and nurture us and teach us everything. Mm-hmm. And in most cases, that is not
yeah.
possible.
Yeah.
And we end up learning the hard way.
Right, exactly. Learning as we go along.
If we learn at all. And those that don't are instructed by various propaganda outlets to mm-hmm. to find ways of rationalizing their failure
mm-hmm.
and, in even worse, condemning other people
exactly.
who are failing
exactly.
by saying you're not working hard enough.
Right.
You must be dumb. You haven't figured out to do, which means there's something automatically deficient about you.
Right.
When in fact there are other ways of dealing with our personal psychologies.
That's what I find so discouraging lately, is like there's this attitude that people that are low income, people of color, women, the gay, lesbian, queer community, any kind of a minority that's struggling,
mm-hmm.
that's having issues, they're not working hard enough. They're not smart enough. It's their fault. There's a lot of victim blaming going on. And it's really discouraging. For me. But I wanted to ask you about your book, Death Confetti. You mentioned when we were talking earlier that it was a compilation of some of your some stories that weren't quite as negative or dark as some of your other writing.
Yeah.
So what about that?
So when I was originally asked to do this book, the publisher was particularly resonating with a lot of the profiles I had of random encounters on buses,
sure.
on sidewalks, usually with either bizarre people with homes or
mm-hmm.
or unstable homeless personalities.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
the publisher thought there was a vitality and a strange combination of poetry, humor, and tragedy going
yes.
on at the same time.
Definitely definitely poetry and definitely humor.
And so originally we were talking about, well, the publisher said, we want you to work with us. And so then we were trying to hash out, well, what direction should this book go?
How did you get into contact with them?
They approached me over
oh
Facebook.
Oh my gosh.
Which is what a lot of publishers
That's
are doing
That's like
these
every
days.
Writer's dream.
Yeah.
Good for
it's,
you.
If you keep pushing work out there, there was more strategy than that, meaning I made sure to befriend a lot of
sure.
other writers
sure.
and people
right.
I knew were connected with publishing.
Yes.
There's
okay.
like you have to think these things out a little bit. But then the rest is
I have a friend, my friend JD Chandler, and he was approached by the History Press because he had been doing his website, Slabtown Chronicles, which chronicles
yeah.
Portland murder. The History of Portland Murder. He'd been doing that for years, and they contacted him, and they're like, hey, JD, would you like to write a book for our publishing company? It really is every writer's dream to be approached by a publishing company. I've never been so lucky.
maybe
one day.
You just keep working, and to some degree,
mm-hmm.
Focusing on what you really want to put out
yeah.
there. Meaning, what tone you want, mm-hmm, and then mm-hmm find others who are working with that yeah tone. But think, there's a lot of chance involved. There's yeah always yeah chance involved.
I think it's wonderful that that you've written a book that focuses on these kinds of marginalized people and the scenes and the you know the atmosphere of the streets. Mm-hmm. I'm working on a book of fiction and memoir, and I've titled it Burnside Field Lizard and Collected Stories, and it's about, a lot of the stories are about my encounters with street people, mm-hmm, because sometimes they're the most unforgettable and tragic and moving characters you're ever going to meet.
And sometimes they're the most open.
Yes.
Because all of yes these shells of having, when you have even a fraction of stability in your life, there's a temptation to hide your persona, hide behind personas,
right,
hide behind the home you can go back to, hide behind electronics, hide mm-hmm behind costumes, hide behind yeah a number of things. But people who are homeless or in other ways having to constantly be mobile, constantly right survive, there's no time
yeah
to develop the or have refuge in the barriers
right
that the rest
right
of us do. Right. You find
yeah the social barriers.
Yeah, the social barriers you find, or financial barriers, you mm-hmm find, you can have instant and very meaningful connections with
yeah
people who have been cracked open.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true,
and more real,
yeah,
and more loving,
yeah,
and more resonant in mm-hmm every mm-hmm dimension.
Yeah, yeah. So that's it's just a great book, and I really enjoyed it, and I've read it once, and I will read it again, no doubt. And you have photographs in it too, which I think is really neat.
There are many. There's a mixture of personal photographs mm-hmm and street photography. Mm-hmm. The street photography shots are taken by Kurt Eisenmore, mm-hmm, and the performance shots are taken by a variety mm-hmm of other mm-hmm photographers, because there's some of me at readings in year two. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to go use this as a chance to go back and answer your other question, which mm-hmm is, when I said there, when we were talking before the show, and I mentioned that there was darker material,
yeah,
or
yeah
more personal material that didn't mm-hmm get in here. Mm-hmm. It was, especially with the press that deals with more journalistic material, I was originally going to keep the book to more impersonal profiles.
Okay.
But it ended up, as the publisher and I discussed things more, that mm-hmm we decided to put more of my private stories in. Like there's,
sure,
like there's some things about abusive relationships,
sure,
and some
sure
things about friends I know who have gotten into a variety of bad situations. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I picked, it's strange to say, I picked some of the lighter material like that, because I felt some of the darker, more personal memoir type things would be better in a different book entirely.
Yeah, I definitely see the humor. There's a lot of humor in it, a lot of dark humor.
Mm-hmm.
And it works really well. The danger of sharing really personal stories is like, I think my weakness as a writer is I'm too sentimental. I know it. People affect me too strongly if I connect with them. And I mean, I'm not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. And recently I had a blowout on Facebook, which I really regret. I was very angry about something that happened in the last couple weeks. And I antagonized a lot of much younger people in their 20s and called them names, and so there's that element you can, exposing layers of yourself, what you're willing to expose in an in-person situation as opposed to when you're on social media.
Yeah.
And I think
it's, social media is its own theater.
It is.
That's very different than what we're triggered to be in
yeah
person, in the flesh.
What I've discovered is, when I'm on social media, I've been accused of being like a computer lion or something, that I don't know what they call them.
Computer lion,
like somebody that's a big shot behind the glass, you know. I think when I'm on social media, I'm really expressing my innermost feelings and thoughts more honestly than I would if I was in an in-person mm-hmm situation. And so I can get really angry And it's not that I'm a coward. I was accused of being a coward because I write about things that are very difficult to write about, memoir essays regarding, sexual assault and things like that have happened to me. But there's just this element of feeling comfortable sometimes when you're on social media and you say things more honestly, and then of course it comes back to haunt you. But
everything comes back to haunt us.
Yes.
And off social media as well.
But what I like about this book is the focus on street people and the focus on the less understood and the marginalized, because in this book I'm writing, and I'm still not finished with it, there are several pieces that I've, fiction pieces and memoir, where I focus on street people because I'm trying to bridge that gap in a way, I guess, so that people can perceive odd street people that they might be afraid of really as human beings, because it's so easy to regard people like that as less than human, especially if they're a drug addict or if they're extremely mentally ill. And there's so much lately in the last few years, such a lack of compassion, and you see it politically. It's discouraging. But I really enjoyed that you focused on street people so much, and I look forward to any future books that you publish.
As a matter of fact, I'm working on a book with a different press than this that is even more politically
cool
oriented.
Nice.
And in our discussions of the project, it'll have more street profiles like Death Confetti does, but it will also have more pieces that emphasize the problems of living in a class war situation.
And that's totally Portland. Portland has been at war with each other with regard to class since the very beginning. I mean, I've done some research. I've read some profiles on historical figures and the political climate of 100 years ago, and it's amazing the class wars that occur in Portland and the racism, the undercurrent of class and how it relates to race in Portland, and of course Portland being the whitest city in the country.
Yeah.
Which I just recently learned. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I was born in Baker City, Oregon, and I moved to Portland when I was 18 months old, so I've lived here my whole life.
Yeah, the residential area is considered, it's in the 70s, 70-something percent white. Yeah.
And I had no idea.
It's long. The city has a very long tradition of segregating people of color and of different social origins in general.
And I'm just beginning to learn about those things. So I'm very new to learning about how racism impacts people. And I have black friends and I have black family that I've learned a lot from in the last 5 years. But I still have a lot to learn. I was wondering, so this next book you have coming out, do you have a title? Or?
I was thinking of calling it Earthquakes in Candyland.
Oh, I like that. And I love the fact that this book has a subtitle.
Yes.
I love subtitles. It gives the book more kind of richness,
Yes. Do we have a minute to read a piece from the book?
Yes, absolutely.
I think that especially one thing we were also talking about before the show was I had a radio show on KBOO Community Radio for 9 years, and it was all live performances. Very rarely would I have interviews be the majority of the segment, but I always savored the moment where, after talking about the art, you get to experience what it's like, the live experience of it. And I'm going to read a very short one-paragraph piece from this called Other Candy.
What page?
It's page 153 in Death Confetti. And
I see it. Yeah.
This is one of my late night supermarket encounters.
Oh, I read this. I like this one.
I pride myself in my feel of a face. Before she was a tweaker, the woman with the black hair and the tattered business blazer was Irish. Along with her boyfriend, a beet red weasel in desert army boots covered in mud. She hauled bags of bottles into the midnight supermarket, scavenged, presumably, from the same place the couple had scavenged, the upended oven, coils of wire, boxes, and dented who knows what sort of trash piled in a nest, piled like a spaceship made of junk on top of the pickup truck. The man waited for a clerk, one of several teenage stoned dudes listening to satellite emo, while the woman kneeled before a candy display, whispering words, words that wove and gnawed at the air like her nails now gnawed at the blisters on her face. She was once cheerleader pretty, probably 5, 10 years ago. The business checks of her jacket told me she was still trying to be. She got up from kneeling and said out loud, "Where's the rest of the candy?" I pointed to half an aisle of candy, more candy than anyone could name or dream of. "Not that," she muttered to the floor. "I want other candy." That's one of the brief profiles.
Oh, I like that. I like that.
Thank you.
One of the things I remember seeing when my daughter's 25. She just turned 25, and she probably was 6 or 7, and I had just dropped her off to school, and I was coming home, and I was passing the old Fantasy on Burnside.
Mm-hmm, which is... it's gotten much smaller.
I think it's like a dog grooming place now. And there was a little old woman sitting at the bus stop there. There's a little island, and she was eating something, and she had a scarf, and it was tied under her chin, and she had a beige felt jacket on, you know, coat, you know. Mm-hmm. And she just looked like any little old lady that you would see. And I walked up, and I noticed she was eating something with a spoon out of a plastic container, and I thought it was pudding or something like that. Uh-huh. And I got closer, and of course it was raw hamburger. And it was just one of those things. And then I looked at her face, and as I got closer, she kind of snarled. She kind of looked over at me and gave me this dirty look as she was just spooning raw hamburger into her mouth. And it was just, it was probably about 1998. And it's just one of those things that you never forget. You
yes.
know?
There was a period of time when I was making copies at Kinko's, which is now FedEx Kinko's. But anyway, there was a homeless woman who was hanging out there quite a bit, who also... in her mid-70s. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't know she was homeless at first, because from afar she had this down jacket and a nice muffler tied about her waist and her hair carefully put in a bun or some a meticulous hairdo that showed it that for many years of her life she had an eye for presentation. Mm-hmm. And she was making copies of various things. She had all these newspaper articles and drawings and collage things set up on the counter but she wasn't entirely coherent. And then when you get up close, you'd realize that there was a lot of dirt on her jacket that looked like just a regular white jacket from afar. And somehow, in the course of her being homeless, she had broken her wrist. She was trying to hide it because she didn't want anyone to notice that. So she'd keep putting it under the edge of her jacket, like, well, kind of like you see the paintings of Napoleon.
Right.
And and then my friend and I started talking to her and got more of her story. And there's a lot of depth beneath these appearances that you can ignore or cast off from afar.
I've seen homeless women like that. There was one woman I saw for a long time, and I think she was Russian, and she was always dressed really well, and she always had a lot of makeup on, and she was in her late 50s, early 60s, and I would see her around Southwest Jefferson Street, and she was homeless. Yeah. She was always homeless. She had a push cart with her, but she always looked really well-dressed and clean, and she always had a lot of makeup on, she was a homeless woman that I never forgot, you know, and wondered about.
Yes.
My problem has always been feeling apprehensive about approaching certain homeless people, and because you never know what they're going to do and if they resent being approached.
Yeah.
And it's a rich source of material for writing.
Well, like most human beings, it's a case by case basis.
Yeah,
some people are eager for and cherish mm-hmm. having human contact.
Yeah.
One of the pieces for the book I'm working on next happened a few weeks ago in the big Portland snow stage, ice storm, whatever you want to call it, that we had unseasonably cold weather. The city froze over for 2 weeks. Portland isn't prepared for that kind of weather at all. We usually don't have that. And there were a lot of homeless people dying or reaching near death.
Four people died.
On the street.
Yeah, four, one woman and three men, I think, froze to death.
And a lot of people being picked up by ambulances and having to be immediately taken to shelters or emergency rooms because they were on the way to it. And I met a homeless man on the bus who was just riding the bus all day, as long as he could to stay out of the cold. And he started rapping homemade Christian raps to me. And I was listening and smiling at him, and he gave me a big hug and said, "You don't know how important it is that someone actually listened to me instead of turning their head out the window."
I know, exactly. Yeah. It's hard not to be impacted, especially if you have a heart, you know. There was a couple of years ago a writer, kind of a casual writer, not really a writer for a local Portland online news source, wrote an article about a homeless man coming in and stealing a plate of food from some Safeway over in the Pearl. And he wrote this really critical, he's actually a really great guy. I'm not going to name him, but he's a really great guy. But he wrote this really critical short essay about, you know, these, you know, millennials and being homeless and they're all looking for a handout. And I was so angered by his article that I wrote a response to it. And I wrote kind of the opposite experience of buying a homeless man a meal over at the Safeway on Jefferson Street. And it was kind of like pointing out the opposite of what he was, and also pointing out that most homeless people are mentally ill. Mm-hmm. And there's a high percentage of mental illness. But yeah, it's pretty frustrating when people are so judgmental and so indifferent, you know, to the humanity of people that are struggling on the streets. And that's why I've written some of these stories for this next book, which I probably will end up self-publishing through Oregon Greystone Press. But that's basically my motive, is just to humanize people and to get the reader to connect with homeless people I've known. And the title of the book, Burnside Field Lizard, is the title of the main story that I'm writing about a prostitute who's really a composite of about four different prostitutes that I would see around Burnside over the years, that I would speak to and say hello to. But it's important to me to humanize, and that's mainly the reason that I decided to do that. But it's so nice to get to know a writer who also feels that this kind of a focus is important. But when do you write? Like, what time of the day do you write? What is your process?
I suffer from a disease of not actually scheduling writing, and most of it just compulsively happens. Most moments when I do work on it, it compulsively happens. So the main time that I have to attack it with discipline is when I finally have a project where I have to collect the things and properly edit them for publication. Yeah. Otherwise, it's really random.
Yeah, I have the same kind of attitude. I'm pretty flexible. I don't get up and write starting at 7 a.m. every single morning. I read an article in Poets and Writers magazine once, and this guy was like, this famous male writer, you know, you have to get up every morning and you have to do it the way I do it. And it's like, when people
I've
start...
heard that.
Yeah, when writers create those poemic assertions about this is what you have to do or you're not a writer, it's like, back off, because every writer has their own unique process.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll sometimes go a week without writing.
Yeah.
And then I'll write for 15 hours straight and just feel recharged. And anyhow, this is the first half of the show, and thank you so much, Jennifer, for being on, and I'd like to have you on again in the
future.
You're
welcome. I would be honored.
Thank you so much, and we will be, I'll have Christine Van Order on the second half, and I'll see you in just a minute.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these days and times. tell a friend.
Hello, you're on the second half. You're watching the second half of Oregon Voters Digest, and I have a wonderful guest today. I have Christine Van Order. She's a social activist and an aspiring politician and working hard to change the laws for sex offenders and just doing a lot of great work. Hi, and welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
Yeah. So, what did you want to talk about? You had put together some questions.
Yes, there are quite a few things that I'm working on right now, but I've been able to almost use one goal to help affect another goal, to join it to another goal so that there's maximum impact for when legislation actually makes it to committee. And it's all towards victims' rights, which is something that I'm new to, forced into it, you know? Mm-hmm. And so that's how I kind of heard about you and some of your writings, because you had written about your experience. Yeah. So that was my first kind of, you know, seeing this is what it's like to be an advocate. You speak, you speak the truth, you speak truth to power, there is no room for fear in this business. There's no room for breakdowns. Mm-hmm. There's no room to live in the past. It's always looking forward.
Right, right.
And so having that legislation to look forward to is extremely therapeutic.
Yeah.
Especially if the way the laws are currently in Oregon, you feel are stacked against you. This is a great area for, you know, women or victims or just anybody who feels like they have, the system is not necessarily working for them or in their favor, if there's something they'd like to change, there's a very easy way to change it, because we have the most accessible government that I think of any state I've ever even been to. You can just walk right in the Capitol and there they are.
That's interesting. I've never been there. I need to go there. But we're both survivors of sexual assault and sexual abuse, and you have become a very vocal activist trying to change the laws so that sex offenders, repeat sex offenders, get harsher sentences, which I approve of, because sexual abuse is one of the hardest things to overcome. It really destroys a person's it can destroy a person's inner identity and their self-esteem, and it takes years to get over the psychological trauma that sexual abuse causes.
The financial impact, though, which is, you had written something with the actual lifetime loss of human capital.
Yeah.
And so when you put that into words and you look at the numbers, and I take those numbers per person, when the average abuser has, I don't know, who knows, hundreds if they get away with it for long enough. Yeah. And then I start comparing those numbers to what it costs to fund a closed custody bed. And I think that it's worth investing in prison beds for people who will never be safe enough to just walk the streets without letting their predatory ways hurt other people.
And you know, sex abuse is such a complex issue, because it's a learned behavior. So most offenders, most predators were victims at one point. But there's a point of no return for certain offenders, that they make a conscious effort not to rehabilitate themselves. They make a conscious effort to just reject that, and they go forward and they just continue to offend. Those are the offenders, and there are a lot of them.
And that costs the state a lot of money too, because with the expansion of Medicaid and you know, even private insurance, it really does cover a lot of therapy that is ends up being court mandated.
Yeah.
In lieu of a longer, harsher sentence, people, and we have a very merciful justice system. Mm-hmm. I mean, Oregon loves to give people chances. Mm-hmm. Hey, I've needed a couple of those chances myself, so I'm not knocking the fact that we have a wonderfully diverse way of approaching criminal justice issues. We have invested record amounts of money in transitional housing, in just treatment programs, everything to try to help people find that path. Mm-hmm. When we invest, I'd say hundreds of thousands of dollars in one particular case that I can think of, into someone with prison time and with therapy and with free transitional housing and, you know, the works, and that person continues in that behavior, there comes a time when you need to ominously just put your foot down and say, okay, enough is enough. We need to segregate you from a vulnerable population, because basically some people, everybody's vulnerable to them because that's their nature.
One thing that frustrates me, and I know you can relate to this, you're a little younger than I am, and you have taken charge of your life in a much better way. I was 35, which was a long time ago, when I even started taking classes and started thinking for myself and started trying to undo the damage that sexual abuse and sexual assault had inflicted on me.
Wow.
So you're doing a lot better than I was at that point.
Well,
but one of the things that really frustrated me was victims aren't cared for in the way that offenders are. And I think back to what it did to me, how it put my life on hold for so many years, how I hid from reality and I hid from my own self-improvement, and I ended up choosing people that were really not very nice, that were abusive to be with. I just fell into all of the typical dynamics of someone who's struggling to overcome and understand what happened.
Yes, and you think about all those years, and like, especially like with what you're doing with your life now and all of your goals now, just think of how many you would have accomplished if you had been able to start kind of almost on time when in your early, you know, 20s, when most people are finishing college and all that good stuff.
Exactly.
So that took so much. And, you know, for me, it might have been like that for me had I not ended up in the Oregon State prison system. I was forced, and I was mandated by state law to participate in therapy and cognitive restructuring in this wonderful program called Pathfinders. And not only that, but, you know, anger management.
Anger management.
It was...
I struggle with that. I struggle with that today.
Right?
Yeah. I have anger issues today.
I still have to dig into my toolbox sometimes to get that cognitive restructuring. Like, okay, I know this. I know this. I was fortunate enough to... I got a free education in prison. You know, when I went to prison, I was 19 when I committed my crime, but I had not even finished eighth grade. So here I was... No education, no future, no nothing, headed probably for self, well, definitely for self-destruction. And I just one day decided to commit a crime, and it landed me with a Measure 11. And I have to say, even though I do believe that Measure 11s do need good time, there is, and I do believe that I deserved every single day that I got. And that's hard for some people to admit, but I have to say that I needed it. And I have to say that it was probably the best thing that ever happened to me. And so when people say there's, you know, oh, prison's the worst thing that could ever happen to you, eh, I think we both know there are some worse things that can happen to you than actually being somewhere where you're actually safe, not only from others who seek to target young girls who have no one to protect them, which is what I was, and man, they just zero in on you too. And so, but I was safe from myself. I was, and it gave me a chance to learn and grow, because I did not know who I was. I had never been able to learn about myself or think for myself or grow. And so that gave me the time to do it. And I wish everybody could do that without having to go to prison first.
Yeah.
Because that's an expensive way to learn about your path in life.
I've actually talked to several people who've said that, you know, they committed a crime and they went to prison for 5, 6, 7, 8 years, mm-hmm. and have said that it was the best thing that ever happened to them, because they were able to have social structure and they were able to get an education. Obviously, Oregon prisons, I think, are a lot better than a lot of other prisons.
They're the gold standard nationally.
They are. Yeah, there are prisons in the South and prisons even in Washington that are just awful.
Yeah, I feel bad criticizing Oregon because, you know, I'm working mm-hmm. with them right now on right. some stuff, the DOC. We're working on some things. But I almost feel bad criticizing them for the areas where they need to improve
right.
because I look around at other yes. states and I'm like, wow, it almost feels like I'm nitpicking. Mm-hmm. But the thing that, you know, with women being incarcerated and men being incarcerated, mm-hmm. they have finally now decided that there's totally different ways you need to approach mm-hmm. each mm-hmm. individual population.
Right.
And that's kind of where I would like to use this opportunity to take all of those things that I dreamed about changing about the prison experience mm-hmm. and seeing what can be implemented. Because
yeah.
you have to recognize your window of opportunity. Mm-hmm. You know, other people set the agenda of what items at the Capitol get attention. It's
right.
kind of like, this session, it's this. This is getting attention. We're working on this. Mm-hmm. This session, it could be something completely different.
Right.
So recognizing that time, and I think victims' rights and prison reform, those are two things that can go hand in hand.
Absolutely, I agree with that. And it's so important because what can happen to you after you've been abused a number of times and traumatically abused is that, you mentioned anger management. You know, I have issues with anger, and sometimes it comes out when I'm on mm-hmm. social media, and recently I had a blow up on social media. I flipped out, and I'll be honest, I kind of alluded to it when I was speaking with Jennifer Robin earlier, mm-hmm. but I got really angry because of someone had posted a video of some activists going to Ted Wheeler's home. And what triggered me mm-hmm. was the fear and the panic in his wife Katrina's voice.
Yes.
I'm a mother. My daughter's 25.
Mm-hmm.
And I can remember being a mother. I was a single mom for almost 9 years. And I can remember how alone we felt, how hard it was to protect her,
mm-hmm.
all the weirdos that were trying to get a date with my 13 and 14 year old daughter, my virgin daughter, and just
right.
and when I watched that video, I just became enraged and I flipped out and, you yeah. know, said
because
things
there are
and
lines that can be crossed, and you know, sometimes
yeah.
I'm someone who's, I've been told recently, hey, Chris, you kind of cross boundaries sometimes. So I'm like thinking, okay, boundaries. So boundaries mm-hmm. are kind of a new concept for me, because I'm like, as I meet you, I'm like, what's up? Let's
right.
talk.
You know,
talk,
we have
you know?
That in common, because I tend to be very direct. I'm like that too. And I was actually...
I prefer the company of direct people, truly.
Totally. I do too. And, you know, when we were first getting to know each other, I think I got a couple messages from people warning me about you and just be careful, one person said. And I thought, you know, there's nothing about Christine Van Order I don't like.
Well,
everything
here's
about
the thing.
This woman I really like and admire.
Well, let me tell you, I've given people reason not to like me. And if they don't
I
like
have
me,
to.
Honey, there is a good reason for it. And I probably worked hard because I also like have boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
And if someone will not respect my boundaries,
mm-hmm.
I, because of my history,
right.
I have found, and my therapist has helped me realize, that I become super aggressive
sure.
to keep people potentially at bay.
Right, and you have to. It's called survival.
Well, imagine how Ted Wheeler felt not having that safe boundary. You know, it's
yeah.
like, especially in this time of awakened activism. I mean, I have two daughters that are 8 and 12, and I look at their list of goals, and they are little activists. They are learning it at school. They are learning it through, you know, coming with me. My daughter,
mm-hmm.
she's at home earning some money right now, my mm-hmm. oldest. And so otherwise I wanted to bring her here. I feel very comfortable taking my daughters to the
mm-hmm.
Capitol
mm-hmm.
and letting them sit in the governor's seat and letting them know, you know what, one day this could be you.
Mm-hmm.
Because mm-hmm. That's how we're training our kids now, is to be
yeah.
leaders, because now
yeah.
we realize how critical it is to have
yes.
good leaders, new voices,
mm-hmm.
fresh ideas. And I think Ted Wheeler is, I think he's going to do okay. just because of the way he handled that was such grace.
Well, and yeah, he did.
Friendliness.
He did. And my husband and I both think that he shouldn't have opened the door. Okay, but he did handle it with grace because you never know what's behind that door. And there were more than 5 or 6 people. But he did handle it with grace.
He did.
And he let the man, I don't know his name, but he let him read his statement.
Yeah.
But I also understand his wife's anger and her sense of fear. And that's what
I would have let her come out and tell him a little something. That's what I would have. I'd say, I dare him to come to my house. If I ever actually do get elected, which I don't know if I was asked if I was going to run again. And I thought, you know what, why do I have to run if I can just go to the Capitol and ask people to do what I want nicely? You know, it's like I'm making these kind of going to these different places, you know, and volunteering for people that I think have really good ideas and are good leaders.
Yeah.
I don't have to live necessarily in their district. I have friends all over.
Mm-hmm.
Trust me, I have a friend in everybody's district.
Mm-hmm.
And but there's you meet people down there. And you can tell they work really, really hard, and they're really passionate, and they get so energized to see and hear just the ideas that go along, and also the commitment of a lot of the people down there right now. I think it's encouraging, which might be adding to this community activism movement that's going on, is because we know now we can get things done if we want.
Yeah, and one of the issues recently in Portland is just the unbelievably large homeless population.
Yes.
The camps that dot the city in the residential areas, industrial areas, and the lack of affordable housing. There's no way that my husband and I could move into Portland proper at this point. We live in Washington County in an area that is designated as Portland, Oregon, but it's not really Portland, Oregon. It's basically Washington County. There's no way that we could afford to move into Portland now. We're pretty much stuck at the house that we're at.
Okay. When I had to go to the doctor's recently, had to take a kid in. When the doctor is complaining to me about housing prices, and I know how much doctors make, this was literally like, it was a week ago, and I'm thinking this doctor is complaining about housing prices, and I'm just thinking, okay, that makes it real.
Yeah.
You know, when you see people complaining about stuff on the news and in the newspaper, that's one thing.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, you know, not just the housing, but when you walk downtown. And my family, when it's nice outside, we'll go walking downtown. And they're like, oh, Mom, please stop talking to every single person we pass. You know, I'm like, I want to... You know, and I'm sitting there, and there's a group of homeless kids. I have no problem going up and talking to them.
I do that, too, and I used to do that when my daughter was a teenager, and it would make her really angry.
Oh.
We would go downtown a lot, and sometimes people would spare change me, and I would stop and give them change or a couple of dollars, and it would make her really angry, and it still does. She has a very different idea about it, but yeah.
You know why? Because we're people. And we care about people, and those are the kind of people you need to have, you know, in office and in leadership positions because it's all about service.
Yeah.
It's about you have to serve people that you not only don't agree with, but you may not like at all.
Right.
And, you know, you have to be able to put every single thing that you feel aside and think about the greater good.
Right.
And what frustrates me is I have told people, give me the land and the money and I will solve this homelessness thing. Because I have the dream of, you know, yurts. I guess it's because my own heart longs for yurts.
You like that. That's a wonderful idea.
I have seen some of them decorated so beautifully and, you know, with all the solar panels and getting them self-sustaining. And plus, I was reading this book called Welfare Ministry by Ellen White. And it talks about how to properly, you know, address societal needs that were present back then, but... Nowadays, it's like times 100.
Mm-hmm,
it's like large scale to where I've had to call the yurt company and said, so if I call you one day and I need 1,000 yurts, can you do that for me?
Can you
and
help
they
me
said,
out?
They said, not all at once.
Okay.
But I got the information.
How much are they per?
You know what? $6,000.
Wow.
$6,000. Mm-hmm. And that's
a lot better than a $200,000 or $300,000 house.
Yes. Yes, it is. And, you know, with some people that are homeless, they don't like to be put in a box. Right. They don't, you know, they like their space.
That's interesting that you
don't want to be put into a stacked
house. That you would bring that up because I feel very strongly about this issue with tiny houses. Okay, mm-hmm. Tiny houses are a great idea
for some people.
Right. But there's this human beings need space to be creative.
Yes.
And I read a study somewhere a few years ago about people that live in really tiny apartments and people that live in larger spaces. You need a sense of expansiveness physically.
For your mental health.
For your mental health and to be creative and to feel inspired and to have, there's a sense of oppression when you're living in a tiny space. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the reasons that my husband and I won't move from the house that we're at because it's so large and I have, the basement is where I do my painting and mm-hmm. it's just nice to have a lot of space. It's a real a hassle to heat in the wintertime. It's a cold, drafty barn.
It's very cute though.
It has it has a lot of drawbacks, but it's the reason that I stay is because there's so much space.
Yes.
And I eventually want to write an essay about the human need for space and how dehumanizing it is
yes.
to live in these little tiny houses. And yet to live, what is, you know, is it better to be homeless and outside?
Yes.
Or in a little tiny dwelling that has a bed where you can be warm and you
can
survive?
I know some people who are just chomping at the bit wanting mm-hmm. a tiny house.
Yeah.
And it really suits their needs.
Yeah.
And, you know, for some it might not be claustrophobic, but they like the coziness of it and the minimalistic
yeah.
approach.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, that's one thing.
I think it's a wonderful idea in many respects, but it's also kind of symbolic of how our culture has just kind of degenerated to a point because we have so many homeless people, not just yes. in the state of Oregon, but nationwide.
Did you know that Oregon Corrections Enterprises is going to start building some of those tiny houses? They're actually going to use the inmate training program
That's
for that.
That's wonderful.
Because I mean, it's
that.
Wonderful. It's transferable skills. They
mm-hmm,
can
sure.
go. There's manufactured mm-hmm. housing places here mm-hmm. in Oregon where they can actually, that are felon friendly mm-hmm. and they can go get jobs. So, and that's another thing I would really like to see is a partnership mm-hmm. Between the departments. Mm-hmm. There's a budding partnership between Department of Corrections and DHS mm-hmm. to prevent, you know, the generational criminality more than mm-hmm. that, but this to stop people from going to prison before it even, mm-hmm. you know, starts. Specifically,
yeah.
People who struggle with addiction and
right.
who have children,
right.
which is where DHS comes in.
So what are you planning for the future? Are you going to run again?
You know what? I don't know. I honestly, because I really like who got in there. I had a little bit of an adjustment period because there are a couple things I was like, I don't know about that. But I feel truly blessed that Mark Meek is now the state rep in our district. I probably mm-hmm. wouldn't run unless he just decides he doesn't want to because mm-hmm. it's in good hands.
Good, good.
So.
It's great that you can, you know, have that attitude because that's a generous way to look at it, you know.
I liked both people I ran with. It mm-hmm. was, there were four of us and I never saw the Libertarian. Mm-hmm. Never saw him at one event. But I did, I ran as non-affiliated, and I got more votes than the Libertarian. And here I was, Gary Johnson, all day long, mm-hmm. you know, all about that Gary. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, well, that's at least, you know, when you look at it, that's kind of like, scratch that off my bucket list, mm-hmm. you know, onto the next thing to accomplish. So when it comes to running for office, if I don't have to, and I mm-hmm. can get everything accomplished that I want to, no. No.
So you, when we talked earlier, you did want to mention the baby that was born stillborn. Karen Gunson, the medical examiner, says that she was not, the baby did not freeze to death. She insists that she was born stillborn, and there are medical
yeah.
ways to determine that. So I
right.
trust her. I've spoken with her on the phone several times over the years, and she's really a very nice person. But you wanted to talk about that.
Yes. Now, for people who might not know or might be watching this for the first time, this was the homeless woman that gave birth stillborn, I believe it's correct, at a homeless camp. And the imagery just, it shocked an entire town. It made international headlines.
Right.
And for me, being an advocate and having to go and try to find resources for homeless women, the fact that this woman did not know how her child was conceived and believed that it was immaculate
right.
conception
right, right.
not only denotes mental health issues,
right.
possibly some physical, you know, stuff, physiological mm-hmm. problems. However, it could also be that she was a victim of a crime while on the streets, which homeless women, that is their number one problem. Men have to worry about theft and assault. Women, it's always sexual assault.
Exactly, because women don't have that thing called male privilege.
And there are 4,000 sex offenders on abscond status in Oregon alone. Wow. I thought that my county, when I found out that my county, which is Clackamas, had 49, I thought, wow, that's a lot. And then I found out that Oregon has 4,000 on abscond status. And a lot of them, you know, I have something I'm working on right now to get everybody kind of rounded up back into compliance, because some of them are chronically homeless. They can't find housing to get them back into compliance, but also to get the funding to go search down the sex offenders that have reoffended and that we really need to invest in, because this woman, who knows what happened? We may never know.
So, thank you for being on the show. I do want to say one thing before we close. I want to apologize to all the people on Facebook I offended when I flipped out the other day.
Sometimes she flips out for all of us.
On a particular thread.
Like, you'll do the flipping, say the things we don't really want to say.
I got really angry at some people that were very dismissive of Mr. Wheeler's wife's concerns and boundaries. And I got very, very angry. And I said some inappropriate things. I apologize. And I'm here, and I'm on camera apologizing. Thank you so much for coming to the show, and I would love to have you on again in the future.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Okay, all right. I guess we still have a little bit of time.
Nice.
But anyhow,
we're another minute.
Another minute, another okay. Minute. I said adios too soon.
Yeah.
I will be hosting Oregon Voters Digest for the once a month, and next month I will have two other guests on, and I still have to find them. And if anyone wants to contact me, you can email me at tkdupay@gmail.com. Thank you so much for being on the show, and I'll see you next time.
You set your timer next time.